The process from controlled to assisted ventilation should be synchrony between the patient's own respiratory effort from the breathing center and ventilator delivery of inspiratory flow. The many advantages of synchrony, according to Dr. Muttini, are normalized work of breathing, avoidance of diaphragm atrophy, decreased need for sedation, patient comfort, improved patient-ventilator interaction, early weaning, and improved hemodynamics.
Traditionally, in pressure superventilation, a low respiratory rate in response to increased pressure support level was seen as an indication of improvement. But how can we see if this is true? As well as if tidal volumes of 6-8 ml per kilo predicted body weight are good indicators of ventilatory assistance level? Do we have more vital signs that can be useful to explore the adequacy of ventilatory assistance during pressure superventilation? For the respiratory system, we have a few respiratory vital signs, such as the respiratory rate, tidal volume, and SpO2. We also have other valuable information such as blood gas analysis, imaging, and all parameters derived from mechanical respiratory maneuvers like occlusion maneuvers, pressure volume curves, winning index. But these are not true respiratory vital signs.
So what can the diaphragm tell us about clinical use of pressure support? In Dr. Muttini's experience, the electrical activity of the diaphragm, or EDI in pressure support, may inform us that increasing levels of pressure support may depress the electrical activity of the diaphragm, or may illustrate trigger delay and auto-trigger in pressure support, or may reveal ineffective patient efforts to breathe.
In terms of timing asynchrony in supported ventilation, the timing asynchrony, that is discrepancy between the timing of the neural respiratory cycle of the patient and that of the ventilator, such as auto-triggering and ineffective force, and the flow asynchrony, that is discrepancy between the amplitude of the neural respiratory output and the level of assist from the ventilator, they both result in lack of proportionality, which is very hard to see without EDI. Asynchrony means increased need for sedation, worsening of gas exchange, and prolonged ventilation. It can lead to higher morbidity and mortality because of prolonged ICU stay.
According to Dr. Muttini, the EDI curve reveals common pitfalls with pressure support ventilation. A small patient effort only to trigger the ventilator may result in flow assist asynchrony, where the patient is not in control of their breathing pattern. Timing asynchrony in pressure support between patient and ventilator is greater at higher levels of assistance, leading to reduced respiratory drive and overinflation.
If you want to know and use EDI, you need to know the physiological basis. All muscles generate electrical activity to excite muscle contraction, including diaphragm and respiratory muscles. Electrical excitation is controlled by nerve stimulus and controlled in magnitude by adjusting stimulation frequency or nerve fiber recruitment.
EDI is related to the phrenic nerve activity, which is present in healthy subjects as well as patients with acute respiratory failure and chronic respiratory insufficiency. In the experience of Dr. Muttini, the EDI is a vital sign. The electrical activity of the diaphragm is related to global inspiratory efforts and can indicate anatomical issues such as diaphragmatic hernia, central causes such as no respiratory drive due to sedation, hyperventilation, or brain injury, and peripheral causes such as diseases with phrenic nerve or neuromuscular junction involvement.
If the patient did have any central nervous or peripheral dysfunction that could influence EDI generation or its detection, the EDI value variation tells us something about the patient condition. Increased EDI may be related to respiratory load or exercise. It is related to the increased respiratory drive. Reduced EDI values may be related to increasing unloading with mechanical ventilation or decreased central respiratory drive due to sedation. In monitoring, we find the EDI useful in different ventilation modes, so we can see the adequacy of ventilation support, patient ventilator synchrony, and evolution of neuromuscular deficits and respiratory failure. We can even monitor the EDI of spontaneously breathing patients when they came off of the ventilator. In ventilation therapy, we find the EDI useful in applying the mode Neurally Adjusted Ventilatory Assist, or NAVA.